Welcome back to the second pillar of resilience. Yesterday, we looked at the first pillar to help you build a solid foundation of emotional firewalls as part of the EQ Family Firewalls campaign I'm running this week. It's all about how do you have the right conversations, how do you focus what is in your locus of control, both from a technical perspective, so parental control setting, having the conversations with your child on the do's and don'ts, and having an open channel of communication to understand what is the risk currently within your family, within your household, and how can you reduce that risk. Then there is the implementation part, which is the tricky one, because often we focus on giving advice or developing a new habit, but that is not necessarily sustainable. The habit is a series of behaviors that become your second nature, that become easy to implement. But a habit has to meet a need. When you try to restrict the mobile phone use and technology use and social media use of your kids, then how are they going to meet their needs of feeling seen, feeling loved, feeling connected, whatever it is that they are seeking through social media? Social media is a means. They grew up with it, most of these kids. So taking it away can actually have adverse effects. The resiliency part comes in, the emotional resiliency, to not shy away from the emotional discomfort and from the challenges that lie on the path ahead in building a safer and more secure social media experience for your kids. And the three emotional intelligence tools you can use is first, self-regard, second, empathy, and third, flexibility. Let's start with self-regard. Self-regard is all about how much we love and like ourselves in light of both our positive and less positive qualities. And especially for kids, this is crucial because social media is filled with algorithms that prey on their insecurities. Even as adults, we're never good enough, so we get more ads and more content to buy stuff and to make us feel worse. We live in an age where we value artificial beauty instead of authentic beauty. How is your kids' self-regard? How are they feeling and showing up in this world, in their life? I had this with my son also 2 years ago when he came with a drawing that he drew with a big belly and dark skin and said, "I feel ugly," he wrote. And I almost tear up now when I think back about it. And I had no idea that he was struggling with so much low self-esteem. And I had no idea what was happening at school, because he's a very joyful kid and he's always very social and has a lot of friends. So that was definitely a hard pill to swallow. And from that moment on, I tried to be very intentional also how I talk to him, how I help him develop higher levels of worthiness and self-regard without turning him into a narcissist. I think we need to find the balance between feeling good about ourselves, feeling that we are enough and that we come from a place of self-actualization to do things that fulfill us, that make us feel better, that help us evolve and grow. But that as we are now, we are enough, and that we don't have to prove anything to anyone. And that is a long journey, a difficult one, but one that I fuel every day, so he doesn't fall victim to social media's insecurity traps. And then the other part of this is the resiliency part, because I'm also teaching him to have more thick skin. He's a very sensitive young boy, and up until a year or 2 years ago, slightest comment or feedback took it very personal, always crying. And I'm thinking, how is he going to survive the external world? So I'm not here to shield him from harmful things, in the sense that he also needs to learn how to feel his emotions and not allow his emotions to lead to impulsive actions or to negative thinking, to process his emotions, to disassociate, to not internalize. I talk about this in the 30-day challenge, how we should not associate or internalize our emotions. Not, "I am angry, I feel angry," not I am sad, I feel sad. And the more we take this disassociated perspective, the less we allow these emotions of inferiority to take over, and the less sensitive we become to external triggers. And that doesn't mean we should make our kids less sensitive, not at all. It's a superpower being sensitive. But teaching them the skills of resiliency when they say no to someone wanting information from them online, or when they read harmful comments, that they feel hurt, but they don't blow it out of perspective. Because at the end of the day, when we walk outside on the street, if a stranger tells me, hey, Nadia, well, probably he doesn't know my name if it's a stranger, say, hey, you are ugly. I couldn't care less because I don't know this person. I don't have any emotional attachment. If I feel ugly, maybe I would have reacted because then it is something that I judge about myself. But when we have an emotional attachment with someone, we react because then we become more self-conscious. This happens when they create these relationships online with people who think they are fellow kids or crushes. Then what they think about them and what they want them to do matters, because now it's an emotional connection. So helping them stay balanced and teaching that resiliency skill is critical. The second one is empathy. Empathy is all about being sensitive and understanding of someone else's needs. Now, as parents, we have a lot on our plate. There is quite some workload, stress, life's problems, life's challenges, and life in general. Empathy is quite difficult to demonstrate when you feel stressed, when you feel overwhelmed, because you have to step outside of your map of the world into someone else's map of the world. So you can truly and genuinely demonstrate empathy when you feel calm, neutral emotions, because then you can use that energy. You're not feeling stressed, you're not functioning on survival mode, stress mode, and you can use that energy to truly try to understand your kid's map of the world, right? Not with your own bias or what you think as a parent, but to truly understand where they're coming from, what's going on in their life, and then it can help you adapt your relationship, your strategies, and how you help them become and develop this muscle of emotional resilience in the age of social media dangers. And the third one is flexibility. Flexibility is all about how rigid and stuck we are in our behaviors and ways of thinking based on the emotions. Low levels of flexibility meaning that there's a lot of resistance to change, and higher levels of flexibility means that there is change seen as an opportunity. Now, when it comes to both yourself and your kids, understanding your relationship with flexibility is important. Change happens to us, disruption happens within us. When you, for example, take a drastic measure and take away someone's phone for a longer period of time, you need to monitor it, because if they have low levels of flexibility, they may have very adverse reactions and go to extreme measures, which has happened. This is not to scare or scaremongering or fear, but to understand the consequences of our actions so we reduce the risk of more harm occurring in our family household. I did this with my son as well. I was very calm and very loving, but I took away his technology devices as a consequence to discipline him for something he had done. Now, he was very angry and he was not happy. I stayed calm and centered, and I validated his feeling. I hugged him, I loved him, but he didn't see his technology devices for 1 month. And I was very attuned to his behavior as well. I just paid more attention. So he has higher levels of flexibility. I also have higher levels of flexibility. But if you have lower levels of flexibility, without judgment, there are people who have higher and lower, as well as your kids, then there's going to be more resistance to change. So you want to take this into consideration when you discuss measures to actually foster safer social media use within your household. So you see, the emotional resiliency and emotional intelligence part is key in implementation, implementing the change. The way we live, the way we think, the way we work, we have to change it in order to meet the risks of today's digital age. As parents or as family, we may be going through a lot, so just an additional burden. So be patient with yourself, be compassionate, seek out support, seek out community, and always keep an optimistic point of view, because it's a journey. It's a journey that requires us to show up and protect our kids to the best of our abilities. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for supporting the mission. If you want to dive deeper, you can join the 30-day challenge, where every day I share audios and reflection prompts and the context with practical emotional intelligence and resiliency strategies to help you build that emotional resiliency muscles to help protect your kids from the unseen dangers of the social media world. Thank you, and see you tomorrow. Bye.